Uruguay, a progressive country with around 3 million people. It's dubbed one of the safest countries in South America, but in 2011, drug-related homicides jumped 32% in 1 year. So, President José Mujica did something drastic. In 2013, Uruguay became the first country in the world to fully legalise marijuana.
It will become the first country to oversee the production and sale of the drug.
But personal use of drugs has been legal in Uruguay for around 40 years. Distribution and cultivation, however, that's the illegal part. So, after 4 years of legal weed, I'm keen to know if it's working out. So, I headed to Uruguay to meet up with journalist and weed expert Guillermo Garat.
No problem.
It's perfect for the film. Yeah. I want to be sedated. Yeah.
So we're blazing across Uruguay to get the lowdown from people on both sides of this dope dabbling debate, to see if Australia could take a leaf out of Uruguay's book, maybe even their backyard.
El derecho de imagen le cobramos. Ya que es para Australia.
I want to know what Uruguayans think about legal weed, because initially 65% of them were against it.
Estoy totalmente de acuerdo.
Yo no fumo, pero creo que tipo está bien que sea legal.
Ahora creo que la regulación que están proponiendo en este momento no es efectiva.
Y eso va a matar a la sociedad, la poca que queda.
I want to find out what it was like living under the previous laws. Meet Alicia Castilla. The 72-year-old is an academic and long-time smoker.
He escrito bastante sobre la marihuana y fumo hace aproximadamente 50 años.
In 2011, she was jailed for 5 months for having a handful of plants in a backyard.
Tupac is in the wrapper.
Her jail time is often seen as the catalyst for legalization in Uruguay.
El revuelo que causó mi prisión y todo el debate que generó llevó a esta situación de que, bueno, se buscara la forma de no criminalizar a las personas que plantaban para su propio uso.
And personal use is at the very core of legalization. It's illegal to sell it, but individuals can have up to 6 plants for personal use. And if you're part of a cannabis club, you pay a small fee and you can grow up to 99 plants as a collective. But all growers and users must register with the government.
We are going to see Vico. He's a cannabis grower and he also manages a cannabis social club. He told me he had some kind of 80 plants.
A lot of plants.
Sounds good.
But before we got to Vico's, I wanted to make a pit stop.
This neighborhood is Casabó. It's one of the neighborhoods which is more problematic for the police. Police says that it's ruled by narco gangs.
One of the other main reasons for legalization is to stem drug-related violence and put pot-peddling cartels out of business. So we're going on a mission to see if the dealers they were hoping to destroy were still selling. We came across a smoker with weed, direct from Paraguay.
Forest, don?
Paraguay. Marihuana paraguaya. Está buena, pero siempre mejor cogollo.
Cogollo siempre. So, OK, it hasn't stopped Paraguayan weed hitting the streets, but surely growing your own gear is better than the stuff on the black market. When it comes to growing weed, Vico is God. He runs one of the biggest cannabis clubs in Uruguay.
¿Qué tal?
Hola, Vico.
And there's 38 registered cannabis co-ops like this across the country.
Bueno, pase.
I asked him, what's his problem with illegal weed?
Violencia. Que generas violencia. O sea, en el sentido de que al estar prohibido generas un mercado negro, ese mercado negro genera una mafia y esa mafia genera violencia.
We found some Paraguay weed. What do you think of this? Can you have a look?
Hijo de puta.
¿Qué hijo de puta?
How would you describe that?
Cow shit.
Llamado colín prensado paraguayo. Ese. Que es una... Es algo prensado, así, oscuro, negro, feo. Que no sabes qué tiene en verdad adentro, ¿no? Eso es lo que se conseguía, ¿no? Antes de la regulación.
Why is it better that you grow your own? Is it the same reason, you know, homegrown tomatoes are always better than the bought ones?
Exactamente eso, ¿no? Al vos mismo saber cada paso de tu cultivo de cannabis, sabes al final qué es lo que vos estás consumiendo, ¿no? Y generalmente vas a tener un producto de muy buena calidad, ¿no? Es por eso. Ah, tan ricas estas.
It's hard to believe that this entire setup, this entire house, is actually legal.
With so much weed being grown now in Uruguay, I'm curious to know if it's created a kind of domestic black market. So we've lined up an interview with the police.
What have you just found out?
That the police don't want to talk with the feed. They don't want to talk with anybody. Because for many time, cannabis was prohibited and it was fought by them. And now there is a new law and they don't understand what the law is about.
In some respects, it's helped them. Cocaine and crack seizures have both decreased, but when it comes to weed, cannabis seizures have doubled from 2.1 tonnes in 2013 to 4.3 tonnes in 2016. Meaning there's way more cannabis around, but folks aren't getting involved in the regulated market. In fact, estimates suggest that 57% of weed growers refuse to be registered.
Esta aquí ya... ya fue cosechada parcialmente.
And that includes Alicia.
Aren't you afraid of the government knowing that you've got plants and you haven't registered?
Mira, yo creo que a mí me registraron de hecho. Es decir, todo el Uruguay se enteró que yo cultivo marihuana. Creo que el Estado no tiene por qué intervenir en la cantidad de marihuana que yo puedo cultivar o consumir.
She says in the same way that Uruguay doesn't have a sex offenders register, why should there be one for cannabis consumers?
Me parece que la gente que fuma marihuana es mucho menos peligrosa que un violador. Entonces, no entiendo por qué habría que registrarla.
It's this lack of registration that worries reformed drug user Ismael Pinheiro.
That has increased a lot of clandestine microtraffic, people who grow in their homes and sell to other people.
Ismael is an addiction counsellor. He's on the front line of drug rehabilitation in Uruguay.
Have you seen an increase in people coming through your doors because of legalisation?
Yes. Each year, more people and at low ages are coming here for marijuana. What happens when you legalise a drug? All the people start to use the drug. If more people use a drug, more people will get addicted because it's a mathematical.
And mathematically speaking, Ismael is right. The proportion of high school kids regularly smoking weed has increased from 12% to 17% in the past 5 years.
So you think it's created more problems?
More, no doubt. I don't think. I'm sure that has created a lot of more problems to our country, especially to our youth. Because marijuana, a drug that doesn't let you study well, doesn't let you remember what you learn in class, doesn't let you have the will to go to class. What student can support that?
It seems this regulation game is creating headaches. So we are on our way to meet Augusto Vitale, one of the architects of Uruguay's drug policy. In the brownest corridor in the country, he says cannabis regulation does have some teething problems.
Hay una historia de prohibición, pero también de un uso que se dio de espaldas a la presencia del Estado. Por lo tanto, creo que esa idea de estar en un registro del Estado todavía no está madurada en nuestro país.
And despite these problems, the government is taking it one step further.
En el predio estatal se comenzó la producción de cannabis al inicio del año 2016.
That's right, the Uruguayan government is now growing weed, and you'll be able to buy it from a chemist.
El precio de dispensación del cannabis se ha considerado una variable crítica para poder competir con el mercado ilegal.
A gram of this government-grown ganja will cost you around $1.30 US.
The idea of legalization and decriminalization is not a new one, but the concept of a government growing marijuana and supplying it to its people, well, that's revolutionary.
Armed with the knowledge there was a government crop about to drop, Guillermo and I set out to find it.
Look, it's full of cannabis there. It's not. Do you see cannabis? I can see cows, I can see pumpkins, corn, but we don't know where we have the cannabis.
This is roughly the area where the government is growing cannabis.
And you said they're producing 400 kilos per year.
Yeah, that's what has been told.
So how much is that in comparison to what a drug cartel can bring in?
The plane that came from Paraguay, they used to bring something like 500 kilograms in each trip.
So the cartels are moving more marijuana than the government can produce.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a pity.
Me parece una locura que las farmacias vendan para consumo, una cosa es para consumo medicinal y otras para este uso recreativo.
Senator Veronica Alonso has been a vocal critic of cannabis regulation from the very start.
Creo que eso no elimina a los narcotraficantes ni al mercado paralelo, porque los menores que no pueden ir a comprar a las farmacias y consumen, esos menores, ¿a quién, dónde compran? El mensaje que se les transmitía a las generaciones más jóvenes era consumir marihuana está todo bien. Y para mí no era así. Porque esa es otra de las cosas. Se decía que con esto se iba a combatir el narcotráfico. Uruguay es un país de tránsito en el tema de drogas y Uruguay no tiene un grave problema con respecto al tema de la marihuana.
Veronica has a point. Only 6% of the population smoke regularly, compared to 11% in Chile, 7% in Argentina, and 2% in neighboring Brazil.
De todas maneras, yo creo que ahí hubieron algunas, hubo una especie de lobby internacional. De hecho, hubo apoyos de algunas multinacionales en este juego para que Uruguay fuera como una especie de ratón de laboratorio, ¿no? En la región, para ver cómo funcionaba.
And when the smoke finally clears, it's obvious that Uruguay still has a cannabis conundrum. How on earth do you supervise cannabis legalization?
Para mí ese es el principal problema, porque nosotros podemos regular el mercado de la marihuana, pero no tenemos los mecanismos para controlarlo.
And though legalization may be a work in progress, many people believe it's the best alternative to the war on drugs.
Así como convivimos con el alcohol y convivimos con otras sustancias como el tabaco, tenemos que aprender a convivir con la marihuana lícitamente.